Good morning. In the last lecture, we looked at how to derive or synthesize a rate law for heterogeneous catalyst when the reaction is taking place on the surface. There are different steps occurring while the reaction is taking place on the surface of the catalyst. We already looked at these steps. First is, of course, the external mass transfer, then the internal mass transfer or diffusion through the pores. And actual catalytic site is present on the surface, which is nothing but a wall of the pore, and on this side the reaction would take place. So after the diffusion, that is the second step, we have adsorption of the reactant on the catalytic site. Then the adsorbed species or the adsorbed component, okay, will undergo the reaction. Okay, we looked at isomerization, dehydrogenation reactions. There are many possible reactions, okay, and this transformation will occur on the surface. That is nothing but a surface chemical reaction. Then the product, which is possibly in the adsorbed state, will get desorbed, the fourth step, okay, and then again the back diffusion through the pores of the part of the product, and then the external mass transfer of the product. So these are the different steps, okay, we already looked at them. But while deriving the rate law, we looked at only three steps, that is adsorption, surface reaction and desorption. Only three steps we looked at, and we synthesized the rate law. And then I told you how to determine or how to validate this rate law, or in a sense how to know whether the rate law that we have synthesized is correct or not. That is through the experimental data, okay, performing experiments in laboratory under different conditions, okay, seeing the effect of partial pressures of the reactant, sometimes the products, okay, and see whether the rate equation that we have derived fits well in the experimental data that we have got. So I gave you an example last time of cyclohexane dehydrogenation, and I told you how it fits well for the rate equation derived based on the assumption that the chemical reaction controls. But sometimes it's quite possible that adsorption or desorption would control, okay. So it all we have to check that through the experiments. Now today we are going to look at the other steps which we had ignored before, okay, and these are external mass transfer and internal mass transfer, that is diffusion, okay. So we are going to spend some time on diffusion first, right, and then we will look at external mass transfer. So on a catalyst particle, we have a reactant going first to the external surface, then inside, and somewhere you have a catalytic site where the adsorption, reaction and desorption would occur, and then the back diffusion and then back mass transfer to the bulk of the product, okay. So these are the steps. We are now going to concentrate more next 3-4 lectures on this particular step, that is pore diffusion, okay, pore diffusion, a very important step. I told you that the catalysts are porous in nature, and there are different, or there are many or several pores inside a catalyst. In fact, that's the main reason, okay, the catalyst would have very large surface area. So even if the main active catalytic components, say for example palladium or platinum or nickel or ruthenium, okay, these metals may not have very large surface area, what we do is we put them on supports, okay. Supports have very large surface area, we disperse this catalyst on the supports, okay, so that we get very large surface area and nice dispersion, maximum number of atoms of the catalytic component will be available for the reaction, and I need very less catalyst loading. That is the idea, okay. So we are going to look at the porous catalyst now. As I told you before in the first lecture on catalysis, like there are different types of catalysts. Sometimes you may have to deal with non-porous catalyst where the reaction takes place only on the external surface, like for example gauze, say platinum gauze, silver gauze and all that. In that case, we don't need to worry about this pore diffusion effect. But there are many catalysts which are porous in nature, okay. For them, we need to consider the effect of pore diffusion. The rate equation that we have derived will further get modified because of the pore diffusion effects. And we are going to look at the effect of pore diffusion in this particular lecture. Okay. Now, I have told you that we have a catalyst. I'll redraw the picture of the catalyst again. So, we have this catalyst in which you have different pores. Remember, I had done this before as well. Right? And then I have this particular space which may be considered as solid, continuous solid. Actually, there are micropores inside, but then for our analysis purpose, let us say that I have these spaces where only solid is present, and these are the empty spaces which are nothing but pores, and the actual catalytic site will be present somewhere on these surfaces or the walls of the pores. And in order to access these sites, a molecule has to diffuse, right? So, it will enter the pore from various locations. There will be several such locations through which it will go inside and will get diffused. Okay. So, if the catalyst particle has a radius capital R, overall movement of the reactant molecule will be inside a catalyst particle towards the center, though it will not directly go to the center because there is hurdle here, okay, constriction here, alright. It will go this way. Okay. Why I am explaining all this in detail, because later on we are going to introduce a concept called effective diffusivity, and I am going to relate it to the normal diffusivity when the molecule is moving without any constriction, hurdles and so on. Alright. Now, imagine a situation where I have a molecule which is sitting at the center of this classroom. Okay. And for some reasons, there is a concentration gradient and this molecule has to diffuse, okay, right. Diffusion takes place when you have a concentration gradient or other chemical potential gradient, whatever, and this has to diffuse. Now, this molecule does not know where the walls are. Walls are far away from the molecule, right. And this molecule will flow, assuming or other will get transferred rather. There will be flux because of its movement, right? Assuming that there are no walls at all, because they are far away from the molecule. Now, what is this particular motion of the molecule? Like, how do we characterize it? It is a fixed law, right? And then there is a constant called as diffusivity, right? This diffusivity, okay, has nothing to do with the walls, okay. Right. It is a free molecule present in the bulk, right, and it is moving, right, because of the concentration gradient. Okay. Now, this is not going to experience any resistance otherwise from the walls, but there will be some resistance, and because of its molecular weight, because of the medium and all that, and that is why we have a parameter called diffusivity, and this diffusivity will decide how fast the molecule will move, right. Now, compare this situation as against a molecule which is present inside the pores here. Now, if molecule is moving here, it is going to experience some resistance from the walls. Why? Because look at the pores. What is the typical size of the pore? The pore size is very small, and that is the reason we get such a large surface area. Okay. So, this size is of the order of few nanometers, or it can be angstroms. There are different types of pores: micropores, macropores, mesopores. Okay. They are very small, and the order of magnitude of this diameter of the pore is comparable with the size of the molecule. What is the typical size of a molecule? Say benzene. It is close to 6 angstrom. Okay. So, 6 angstrom molecule size, and suppose you have a pore of say 15 or 20 angstrom, then it is going to definitely face some resistance. Look at a mean free path, okay, of the molecule. Definitely it will experience the existence of the wall around it, and the diffusivity will go down. Okay, so this wall effect, okay, this wall effect, what else? There is, for example, this molecule is moving from the external surface inside. If I look at the actual distance traveled by the molecule, it is this distance, okay, it is this distance, but the molecule is going to go this way, right? So it has to follow a tortuous path, and the diffusivity, the effective diffusivity, if I consider the actual moment this, okay, then the diffusivity will further go down because of this path that it has to follow, right? So for the same displacement or the movement or distance rather, it has to go this way, right? So this is another effect. We are going to put all these effects in one parameter later. Then the pores, these pores, there is no guarantee that they should be of uniform size. There are very few catalysts, especially zeolites and all that, where the pore size is well defined, okay. But take example of, say, ion exchange resin, okay. You can't define the pore size, it is in the range, okay. There is a pore size distribution that you will see, right. So if you take a single pore, the pore itself will have something like this. The wall is not straight, and then there is a possibility that the area of cross section will vary as the molecule moves ahead. So there is again some constriction that it is going to experience, right? And because of that, further the diffusivity will go down, okay, right? So now the effective diffusivity, if I want to determine the effective diffusivity, that diffusivity is nothing but the normal diffusivity and the effect of all these factors, okay. So let us define a term called effective diffusivity. So we call this as DE, effective diffusivity, okay. Effective diffusivity is equal to Knudsen diffusivity DA, which is the diffusivity inside the pores. That means it considers the resistance offered by the fluid inside a pore and the walls of the pores. Now, how do I relate these two? This is definitely going to be larger than this because this is smaller, right? So there will be some effect because there is a space constraint. So some effect will come because of phi p, which is nothing but porosity, okay? Because some space is occupied by solid that is not available for the movement, right, of the molecule. So it has to be multiplied by the porosity. It will further reduce, so porosity is always less than 1, okay. Then I was telling you about the constriction. This is called as a constriction factor because of the variable area, okay. And there is another factor called as tortuosity, okay. Alright, sometimes people club these two and they call it as tortuosity factor, okay. So in some books you will see sigma not present there and you have a tau f or whatever, let's tortuosity factor, okay. But what needs to be understood from this is that this is a normal Knudsen diffusivity that we define for a molecule, right. You have phi here taking effect of, considering the effect of porosity, presence of solid, constriction and then the tortuosity. Okay. This considers the effect of wall anyway, right? But these three factors are the factors which are dependent on the solid that we have, okay, its morphology, its porous structure and so on, right. So, these are the factors which will change from particle to particles, right, solid to solid, catalyst to catalyst, right. So, this is the effective diffusivity. Now, this diffusivity, once I have this, okay, I have this diffusivity in terms of other factors, I can write a normal fixed law type of equation for a solid, porous solid. Okay. So, what this allows me to do is to write mass balance flux equation based on fixed law. Okay. Only difference is instead of a normal diffusivity, we have an effective diffusivity here. Now, let us spend some time understanding tortuosity. Now, the tau that we have defined is, as I said, like the molecule has to follow a path this way because of the pore structure, but actual distance that it travels is only this much. Okay. So, I am at the external surface and I am going inside, but then it has to follow this path. So, the extra path that it has to follow, okay, will result in reduction in the diffusivity. Okay. Now, the tortuosity is defined as actual distance traveled divided by shortest possible distance between these two points. Suppose this is point A, this is point B, the shortest possible distance between A and B, right. So, it is very easy to define or even easy to calculate the value of tau. Suppose I know the angle here. Okay. So, let us say I just approximate it like this, and this is say 90 degrees is the angle. Okay. Can I calculate the value of tortuosity? You can do this exercise. Tortuosity is the actual distance traveled. So, let me say that this is L, this is L. So, the actual distance traveled is 2L. If this is 90, then I can calculate this distance. This is going to be 2L divided by root 2, right? 2L divided by root 2. So, the value of tortuosity comes out to be root 2, which is say 1.41. Tortuosity is greater than 1, it's always greater than 1. Okay. We can't expect to have straight pores, okay. Very difficult. So an extreme situation would be tortuosity is 1, but quite unlikely. Okay. Sometimes the tortuosity can be of the order of 5, 6, 7, 10. Okay. It can be that high. It all depends on the material, okay. And of course, people have control over making a material also. Like this is a separate, altogether different area where we design the catalyst as per our requirement, okay. But then, for our analysis, let's take this tortuosity as a material property, okay. And that will come when the or that can be evaluated, okay, when the material is designed, okay, or it's available. And then we go ahead and get a value of effective diffusivity based on the known value of Knudsen diffusivity. All right. Now, once we know the value of diffusivity, as I said before, we can write the fixed law for the solid. So, let us assume that I have a spherical particle, okay. I have a spherical particle and then the molecule is going inside, okay. Now, this is a center, and let us take a differential element and write fixed law around this. Okay, so this is R plus delta R and this is R. Okay, and the radius is capital R. Okay, now there is a diffusion taking place. As I told you, this particle you are going to have pores inside, but now I am going to assume that the diffusion is taking place straight, okay, along the radial direction. Actual moment is like this, but then now that I have considered that effect of torsion moment, okay, in my effective diffusivity, I am free to write equation something similar to what I do normally for diffusion or flux, writing mass balance, okay, when there is a concentration gradient. All right. Now look at this particle again. There is catalysis happening, in the sense there is a reaction taking place. So as and when the molecule goes inside, it is going to meet catalytic species, okay, and the reaction is going to take place. So it's something happening in parallel. So reaction and diffusion, they are taking place simultaneously, okay. So as and when there is a movement, there is a reaction also taking place. Now the overall rate of the reaction will depend not only on the actual rate of reaction, actually in the sense the one that we derived yesterday, considering the effect of adsorption, desorption and chemical reaction, whichever is the controlling, whatever, okay. So that particular rate and now the rate of diffusion will also matter. You can imagine a situation where the reaction is instantaneous, very fast, okay. Even if adsorption controls or desorption controls or even the reaction, chemical surface reaction controls, all these steps are happening very fast, okay. But then diffusion becomes very slow, that particle, so molecules are not able to diffuse inside, then the overall rate will go down, right. So diffusion is playing an important role here. If the diffusion is very fast, the pores are wide enough, diffusivity is very large, then it is the chemical reaction or whatever, adsorption, desorption at the site that will probably control the overall rate. So try to understand the importance of diffusion now, internal diffusion. We are not yet talked about external diffusion or mass transfer, okay. Fine. So we are going to write the mass balance for this, okay, the flux balance. There is no convection here, there is only diffusion that is taking place. So the flux at R is W A R. This is the way I am defining the flux. W is the flux of component A, that is reactant in radial direction, into 4 pi r square. What is it? The area, right, at r minus W A R 4 pi r square at r plus delta r here. So the flux here minus the flux here, can I write this equal to 0? No, right. There is another term that we need to consider here. What is that term? That term is reaction, okay. If there was no reaction, then this would be equal to 0, right. But there is reaction taking place. So look at this as a CSTR. So material coming in, going out, and plus reacted is equal to 0, right. So I need to add the reaction term, okay. So plus, okay, reaction rate R A into, let me explain all this, later, first let me write it, into rho c, which is nothing but a density of the particle, mass per unit volume, okay, into 4 pi r m square into delta r. Okay, so this is a reaction term, I'll explain this in detail, is equal to 0. Okay, so material at r is going out minus coming in plus generation term. Okay, right. Now Ra will have its own sign depending on whether we have reactant or product. If A is a reactant, it will have a negative sign. Okay, what is this? This is volume. This is volume. 4 pi r m square into delta r. Okay, then rho c is a density. So this is volume, this is density, then density into volume is nothing but mass. Okay, so rate is expressed per unit mass of the catalyst. I told you in the last lecture, most of the times in solid catalyzed reactions, the rate is expressed per unit mass of the catalyst. Okay, so Ra is per unit weight of the catalyst, so you have to multiply it by the weight. So this is to be, this has to be the weight of the catalyst, so density into volume, right. So this is the mass balance, this is the mass balance. Okay, now let's go ahead and try and elaborate this term called WAR, which is nothing but flux. Okay, as I said, we can use a Fick's law for this with spherical coordinates to write the flux equation for W. Okay, WAR. So WAR is nothing but minus DE, that is effective diffusivity, into DCA by DR. Okay, so this is a flux. Now if you substitute for this flux in the main equation, then what do we get? We get, and of course like you have R and you have R plus dr, okay, then just play with the equation, assume delta R approaching 0, I can convert that difference equation to the differential equation, and then what I get is this, d minus dE dCa by dr into r square, but this is d by dr of course, is minus r square rho c Ra dash is equal to 0. So I have just substituted for W and converted the difference equation to the differential equation, and I get this particular equation, right. Now if I want to write the expression for Ra dash, okay, what is Ra dash? Ra dash is the rate of reaction, intrinsic rate of reaction when the molecule is present near the catalytic site. Okay, the molecule is present near the catalytic site. So if Ra, okay, we can obtain it by rate law, then Ra can be k into c raised to n. Okay, so if I expand it further, what I get is d to ca by dr square, just expand this further, plus 2 by r dCa by dr. Okay, let me explain it later, but let me write it first. Kn into Sa into rho c divided by dE. Look at this dE. This dE is coming here. I'm just dividing both the terms by dE, right? That is effective diffusivity into CA raised to n is equal to 0. Now, you would be able to guess what I have done here. I have divided both the sides, okay, by r square, right? So, what is happening is, in you have d2ca by dr square, second order equation, right, dca by dr, 2 by r. Now, I have written expression for Ra dash, that is the rate of reaction at the catalytic site in terms of these constants. So, let us try and understand these constants. Kn is going to be the rate constant, we will see the units. Then Sa is a surface area, okay, is a surface area. Rho c, I have already told you, it is the density, mass per unit volume. Ca is a concentration, raised to n, this n is nothing but order of the reaction with respect to A. The intrinsic kinetics here has been assumed to be nth order reaction. That means, the kinetics is a power law model rather than the commonly used models like Langmuir-Hinshelwood and so on for heterogeneous catalysis. Right? I have a reaction, let us say that I have only an isomerization reaction A going to B, okay, only single reactant present there. So, K into Ca raised to n, right? And this is nothing but a diffusivity, all right. Now, can you guess the unit of Km? I have multiplied it by surface area now, okay. So, now this surface, let us try and understand what is Sa, okay. Sa is the surface area, okay. Now, what is the unit of Sa? Sa is say meter square per gram of the catalyst or kg of the catalyst, whatever. So, this is the unit of Sa, right. Why I have defined this particular parameter here? Because normally Kn would be available in the unit of or unit on the basis of area, that is per unit area. See, now there are different types of rate constants. In a normal reaction without catalysis or other without heterogeneous catalysis rather, normally we have the rate constant per unit volume. Okay. That is why we multiply the rate by volume in many design equations. In the last lecture, I told you that for solid catalyzed reactions or heterogeneous catalysis, the rate is expressed per unit weight of the catalyst. So, that is why we multiply normally, okay, to the rate by W, that is the weight of the catalyst, right. Now, I am defining another rate constant here, okay, which is expressed per unit area of the catalyst. Okay. Which area? It is a area present in the pore, okay, can be very high, very large. Okay. So, per unit area of the catalyst. Okay. So, if you have a rate constant per unit area of the catalyst, it has to be multiplied by the surface area per unit weight of the catalyst. Okay. So, this gives me Kn into Sa gives me the rate constant per unit weight of the catalyst, because Kn is per unit area, Sa is area per unit weight. So, this becomes per unit weight of the catalyst. Okay. Right. And rho c, if I multiply it by rho c, then it becomes my normal rate constant, that is per unit volume of the catalyst. Okay. So, this is nothing but the rate constant expressed per unit volume of the catalyst.
it may be noted that Kn in some standard reaction engineering textbooks, like for example James Smith, the Kn is taken to be per unit mass of the catalyst. So, in that case Kn that they are using in their book is equivalent to Kn into Sa, that is surface area that we are using in our notations.
I hope it is clear. So, this together, like all these parameters together, is nothing but my normal rate constant per unit volume of the catalyst. Now, what is the actual unit of the rate constant? Okay. So, for a first order reaction, Ra is equal to minus KCa, right? And if I want to get a unit of K, Ra is expressed, this is a per unit volume of the rate, that is moles per second, is equal to minus K moles per meter cube. So, what is the unit of K for a first order reaction? It is second inverse. So, this is a K, this is a K, small k normally, okay. This is per unit volume because I am expressing rate per unit volume, but for a first order reaction the unit is second inverse, right, second inverse. That is the unit of first order rate constant when the rate is expressed per unit volume, okay. Now, if I express rate for a first order reaction per unit weight of the catalyst, okay. So, what is the unit, okay, of the rate constant? So, just look at this. Now, this is for the volume, per unit volume. Now, I am going to look at weight of the catalyst. Now, Ra is expressed per kg of the catalyst, right, moles per second, moles per meter cube, right. So, what is the unit of K here? Unit of K is meter cube per kg second, right. This is for the volume, this is for the per unit weight, this is per unit volume, this is per unit weight, right. Now, what about the unit when I express my rate per unit area, per unit area, area of the catalyst, okay. One upon meter square moles per second minus K moles per meter cube. This is for area. Basis is area of the catalyst. So, what is the unit of K here? Unit of K is meters per second, and this is nothing but our Km that we have just written in our balance along the spherical particle, the Km, right. So, let me summarize. I have three types of rate constants expressed per unit volume for a first order reaction. K has a unit second inverse. Second, per unit mass of the catalyst, right, first order reaction, K has a unit meter cube per kg second, and third, surface area of the catalyst, first order reaction, K has a unit meter per second. So, these are the three different units that we probably going to deal with, okay, as and when we solve the problems later. So in our rate equation, Km is this, okay, right, Kn is this, then Kn into Sa is this, okay, and Kn into Sa into rho c, that is the density of the catalyst particle, then it is nothing but the rate constant per unit volume, right. So let's get back to the equation, the original equation that we have derived. You have this equation, in this you have the entire Kn Sa into rho c is nothing but the rate constant per unit volume. Now why are we doing all this? We are doing all this to get the concentration profile inside a particle, okay. We need to know how the concentration changes as we go from the external surface to the interior of the catalyst. And why do we want all that? Because later on I am going to determine how much is the reduction in the concentration and because of which how much is the reduction in the rate, okay, overall rate, right, when the diffusion is important, okay. So that is the purpose. Now we have this differential equation. All I need to know is the boundary condition first to solve this differential equation and get a concentration profile inside a catalyst, okay. All right. So what is the boundary condition here? I have a particle. It is a second order differential equation. I need two boundary conditions. So at r is equal to capital R, I have Ca is equal to Ca bulk or 0, whatever, okay, outside concentration, right.
Since external mass transfer effects are not present, we are assuming that Cas is equal to Cab,
which is something that I am going to see, which is something that I am going to measure. I cannot go inside a pore and get a concentration or measure the concentration. I will see the concentration only in the bulk. Why the concentration inside a particle is lower than what you have outside? It has to be lower. Why? Because there is a resistance faced by the molecules, okay, while diffusing from the external surface to the interior. And since there is a concentration gradient, there is a flow, there is a flux, okay, diffusion that is taking place. Okay. If this diffusion is significant, then the concentration gradient is significant. Even if you have a very active catalyst present inside, it is not going to see the concentration outside a particle, it is going to see the concentration which is smaller than outside, right, and because of which the rate will go down. And our aim is to rather characterize or quantify rather these particular resistance and reduction in the rate because of the intraparticle diffusion, all right. Okay, so R is equal to capital R, Ca is equal to Cab, and there is another boundary condition that I need is equal to R is equal to 0. Since there is a symmetry, okay, you have Ca is equal to finite or dCa by dR is equal to 0. Okay. So with these two boundary conditions, I need to solve this equation. Alright, I need to solve this equation and get a concentration profile. Once I get a concentration profile, my job would be easier. I would be able to know the local rates at every point inside a particle, and from that I can calculate the overall rate, okay, which is going to be the actual rate rather, and is going to be less than what it would be when there is no intraparticle diffusion resistance. Fine. So I have this equation and I need to further modify this to get some dimensionless parameters which are going to give me some idea about the importance of diffusion. Okay. So, let us de-dimensionalize this equation by defining certain dimensionless variables. Okay. So, let us say I express concentration as psi equal to C A divided by C A S or C A B rather, that is what I have used. C A B, what is C A B? Is a bulk concentration, it is at the external surface, you can even call this as C A S. So, some books you may see a notation C A S, okay, C A B, right. And then there is another dimensionless variable that I define is lambda, it is something to do with the radial distance, okay, R divided by capital R. Okay. If I have these two variables defined, the dimensionless variables, dimensionless concentration, this is dimensionless radial distance. Okay. If I have that, then my differential equation gets reduced to a form. So, this is the differential equation that I have. So, I am going to substitute for dimensionless concentrations and dimensionless radial distance. What I get is this. I am directly writing this, you can try it on your own. Okay. So, d 2 psi by d lambda square plus 2 by lambda, okay, d psi by d lambda minus k n s a rho c r square c a b raised to n minus 1 divided by d e, that is diffusivity, into psi raised to m, okay, equal to 0, equal to 0. So, this becomes my non-dimensional form of the equation. Okay. Psi is a dimensionless concentration, lambda is dimensionless radial distance. Now, look at what I have got here. Now, this is a term that is going to tell me something. Okay. So, let me write that term separately and denote it as phi m. So, this phi is different from porosity, this is not phi s, this is phi n. Okay. But then I'll say that phi n square is equal to k n s a rho c r square c a b n minus 1, this term I am just writing it here again, right. Y square, it will be clear later to you, it makes the solution easier. Okay. So, this is a term. Now, look at this term carefully. What do you have in this term? In the numerator, you have the parameters related to reaction. Okay. What do you mean? The rate constant is more, the rate of reaction is more, surface area, rho c, all these parameters have something to do with the reaction. Of course, this r is a, it's common for all, I'll just manipulate this equation further. Okay. Let's not consider r square at this moment, but otherwise rest of the parameters are showing that dependence or the, they are influencing the reaction. What about the denominator dE? dE is something that will affect the diffusion. Okay. Now, let me just manipulate this, or rather just play with this equation further. Phi n square is equal to Km Sa rho C R Ca B divided by dE into Ca B. See, earlier it had, I had Ca B raised to n minus 1. Now, what I am doing is, I am writing Ca B raised to n and I am taking Ca B here minus 0 divided by R. So, what do I see here? I see that this is nothing but the diffusion rate. See that concentration gradient, distance, diffusivity. Something, if you have a linear gradient, okay, then this becomes the flux due to diffusion. Whereas in numerator, you have something that will affect the reaction, actual reaction. So the two rates that I am comparing here. Okay. Now, so this particular parameter phi n square is going to give me the relative importance of actual reaction taking place at a site which may have adsorption, desorption, surface chemical reaction and all, okay, and diffusion. So, relative importance is of these two processes. If phi n is very large, what does it mean? It means that diffusion is slow. Diffusion is important. If phi n is very small, diffusion very fast or not important at all. That means it is like an open catalyst. There are no pores, right? Or pores are very large. So, this value is going to tell me everything. So, for a given reaction, for a given catalyst, if I can determine the value of phi n or phi n square, the magnitude of this particular parameter is going to tell me whether reaction is important or diffusion is important. If this value is very large, then diffusion is important. Important sense is slow and it is going to control the rate. And if it is very small, then I do not need to worry about it. I will just take it as if like there is no diffusion problem. So, this phi n is called as Thiele modulus. Okay? It is a very important term in heterogeneous catalysis that tells you the importance of pore diffusion. Okay? This term is called as, or this particular number is called as Thiele modulus. Okay? So, phi n is Thiele modulus. Okay. I can write it for different types of reactions. Okay. First order reaction, second order reaction and so on. So, the equation that I have is for a spherical particle, because I am talking in terms of the radius of the particle. If I have cylinder, if I have something else, some other shape, then I will have a corresponding characteristic dimension of that particular shape. Okay. We'll look at that separately. Like suppose I have a cylindrical pore, how do I write a expression for, or how do I derive expression for Thiele modulus? Okay, but right now I am doing it for a spherical particle. Okay, and I have the expression given by this. That is phi n is equal to, okay, K m rho C S A C A B n raised to n minus 1 r square divided by d e. Alright. And suppose n is equal to 1, the first order reaction, it becomes very easy. K 1 rho C S A R square divided by d e. Okay. Sorry, this is phi n square. Now, phi 1 would be r root of K 1 rho C S A divided by d e. If I give a rate constant per unit volume, I do not need to write all this. Okay. It would be R K V D E. Why K V? Because it is expressed in terms of per unit volume. It's because this has a unit per unit volume. Right? First order reaction, it will be second inverse. This is a dimensionless number. Look at the units. R meter, K second inverse, DE meter square per second, right? So, if you look at this, no units, okay? So, this is dimensionless number, everything will get cancelled here, right? So, remember phi is a dimensionless number called as Thiele modulus, okay, which gives you the importance of, tells you the importance of pore diffusion effects. If the value of phi is large, then the pore diffusion effects are significant, I cannot ignore them. And if the value of phi is relatively small, say 0.01 or whatever, then I can safely ignore pore diffusion and treat the reaction as if there are no pore diffusion effects and the reaction is taking place on the catalytic surface, which is wide open for me, right? Okay. We will go further and try and simplify this and understand pore diffusion effects in detail, get some more insight in the next lecture. Thanks.